Waldo Jeffers had reached his limit. It was now mid-August. Jumenti had been separated from Marcia for more than 2 months. In 2 months, all he had to show were 3 dog-eared letters and 2 very expensive long-distance phone calls. True, when school had ended and she'd returned to Wisconsin, to Locust, Pennsylvania, she had sworn to maintain a certain fidelity. She would date occasionally, but merely as amusement. She would remain faithful. But lately, Waldo had begun to worry. He'd had trouble sleeping at nights. And when he did, he had horrible dreams. He lay awake at night, tossing and turning underneath his pleated quilt protector, tears welling in his eyes as he pictured Marcia, her sworn vows overcome by liquor and the smooth soothings of some Neanderthal, finally submitting to the final caresses of sexual oblivion. It was more than the human mind could bear. Visions of Marcia's faithlessness haunted him. Daytime fantasies of sexual abandon permeated his thoughts. And the thing was, they wouldn't understand how she really was. He, Waldo, alone understood this. He had intuitively grasped every nook and cranny of her psyche. He'd made her smile. She needed him. He wasn't there. The idea came to him on the Thursday before the Mama's parade was scheduled to appear. He just finished mowing and edging the Adelson's lawn for $1.50, and I checked the mailbox to see if there was at least a word from Marcia. There was nothing but a circular from the Amalgamated Union Company of America inquiring into his own needs. At least they cared enough to write. It was a New York company. You could go anywhere in the mails. Then it struck him. He didn't have enough money to go to Wisconsin in the accepted fashion, true. But why not mail himself? It was absurd, you see. He would ship himself parcel post special delivery. The next day, Waldo went to the supermarket to purchase the necessary equipment. He bought masking tape, a staple gun, and a medium-sized cardboard box just right for a person of his build. He judged that with a minimum of jostling, he could ride quite comfortably. A few air holes, some water, a dozen of night snacks, and it would probably be as good as going tourist. By Friday afternoon, Waldo was set. He was thoroughly packed, and the post office had agreed to pick him up at 3 o'clock. He'd marked the package fragile, and as he sat curled up inside, resting on a foam rubber cushioning that he thoughtfully indicated, he tried to picture the look of awe and happiness on Marcia's face as she opened the door, saw the package, tipped the deliverer, and then opened it to see her Waldo finally there in person. She would kiss him, and then maybe they could see a movie. If he'd only thought of this before. Suddenly, rough hands gripped the package, and he felt himself borne up. He landed with a thud in a truck and was off. Marcia Bronson had just finished setting her hair. It had been a very rough weekend. She had to remember not to drink like that. Bill had been nice about it, though. After it was over, he said he still respected her, and after all, it was certainly the way of nature, and even though, no, he didn't love her, he did feel an affection for her. And after all, they were grown adults. Oh, and Bill could teach Waldo. That scene many years ago. Sheila Klein, her very, very best friend, walked in through the porch screen door and into the kitchen. Oh God, it's absolutely modern outside. Ah, I know what you mean. I feel all icky. Marcia tightened the belt on her cotton robe with the silk outer edge. Sheila ran her finger over some salt grains on the kitchen table, licked her finger and made a face. I'm supposed to be taking these salt pills, but she won't, who knows. They make me feel like throwing up. Marcia started to pat herself on the chin, an exercise she'd seen on television. God, don't even talk about that. She got up from the table and went to the sink where she picked up a bottle of pink and blue vitamins. Want one? Supposed to be better than steak. And then attempted to touch her knees. I don't think I'll ever touch a daiquiri again. She gave up and sat down, this time near the small table that supported the telephone. Maybe Bill will call, she said to Sheila's glance. Sheila nibbled on the clip. After last night, I thought maybe you'd be through with him. I know what you mean. My God, he's like an octopus, hands all over the place. She gestured, raising her arms upward in defense. The thing is, after a while, you get tired of fighting with him, you know. And after all, I didn't really do anything Friday and Saturday, so I kind of owed it to him. You know what I mean. She started to scratch. Sheila was giggling with a hand over her mouth. I tell you, I the same way, and even after a while, she went forward and whispered, "I wanted to grab her." Now she was laughing very loudly. It was at this point that Mr. Jameson of the Clarence Darrow Post Office rang the doorbell of the large sticker-covered frame house. When Marsha Bronson opened the door, he helped her carry the package in. He had his yellow and his green slips of paper signed and left with a 15-cent tip that Marsha had gotten out of her mother's small beige pocketbook in the den. "What do you think it is?" Sheila asked. Marsha stood with her arms folded behind her back. She stared at the brown cardboard carton and suddenly blew the balloon. "I don't know." Inside the package, Waldo quivered with excitement as he listened to the voices. Sheila ran her fingernail over the masking tape and ran down the center of the carton. "Why don't you look at the return address and see where it's from?" Waldo felt his heart beating. He could feel the vibrating footsteps. It would be soon. Marsha walked around the carton and read the ink-scratched label. "Oh, God, it's from Waldo!" "That schmuck," said Sheila. Waldo trembled with expectation. "Well, you might as well open it," said Sheila. Both of them tried to lift the staple flap. "He must have nailed it shut." They tugged on the flap again. "My God, you needed power drill to get this thing open." They pulled again. "Can't get a grip." They both stood still, breathing heavily. "Why don't you get a scissor?" said Gina. Marsha ran into the kitchen, but all she could find was a little sewing scissor. Then she remembered that her father kept a collection of tools in the basement. She ran downstairs, and when she came back up, she had a large sheet metal cutter in her hand. "This is the best I could find," she told her friend. "Here, you do it. I'm gonna die." She sank into a large fluffy couch and exhaled noisily. Sheila tried to make a slit between the masking tape and the end of the cardboard flap. The blade was too big and there wasn't enough room. "God damn this thing," she said, feeling very exasperated. Then smiling, "I got an idea." "What?" said Marsha. "Just watch," said Sheila, touching her finger to her hand. Inside the package, Waldo was so transfixed with excitement that he could barely breathe. His skin fell prickly from the heat, and he could feel his heart beating in his throat. It would be soon. Sheila stood quite upright and walked around to the other side of the package. Then she sank down to her knees, grasped the cutter by both handles, took a deep breath, and plunged the long blade through the middle of the package, through the masking tape, through the cardboard, through the cushioning, and right through the center of Waldo Jeffers' head, which split slightly and caused little rhythmic arcs of red to pulsate gently in the morning sun.